most important thing is you have to select a cohort. You have to collect a baseline information from the cohort. You have to follow that cohort till they develop the disease and analyze the data. What could be the objective of cohort studies? Because we are following some individuals till they develop the disease, we can estimate the incidence of disease. Incidence means new cases. So we select a cohort where there is nobody who is having the disease. We remove those persons having disease. We follow them till they develop the disease. So we can find out how many new cases have come. The cohort study can be analytical, in which we compare the incidence of the disease in individuals who are exposed or in groups who are exposed and in unexposed groups. We will see in detail how this is done. But before that, what is cohort? Any idea? Anybody has heard this? Where from this word came? Yeah? No? So, well, cohort is one of the, this term basically has come. And this cohort is one of the 10 divisions of Roman legion, their army. And in epidemiological context, cohort is a group of individual who share a common experience. So that experience can be anything. 33 students or candidates who are attending this workshop is a cohort. Individuals born in 2007 in a particular district or particular area, they form a birth cohort. Or, as I told, candidates attending the course, this course. What is the basic design? We select individuals who are a group of individuals defined on the basis of presence or absence of an exposure. We select a cohort. We follow them and compare the incidence of one or more diseases. Okay, we start with a group of people or cohort which is exposed and those which are not exposed, as against to the case control study. Case control study, we started with cases and controls. Here we started with individuals who are exposed to particular disease agent or exposure and non-exposed group. We follow them because cohort studies are follow-up studies. Some of these individuals will develop the disease. So they become diseased. Some will not develop the disease. They will remain non-diseased. Then we calculate the incidence in both the groups. That is, incidence of disease in exposed in the red group, in incidence of disease in unexposed group. And we divide these two incidences to get the relative risk. So this is a very simple design to at least appears like that. So in effect, we go from cause to an effect. So this is a forward-looking study, prospective study. The logic always is prospective. Though logic is prospective, there can be a retrospective cohort study also. See, the prospective cohort study in which we recruit study participant at the beginning of observation period. We do initial we collect baseline information. We find out who is exposed, who is not exposed. We remove those who are diseased, and we remain with individuals who are not diseased, who are at risk of getting the disease. We follow them. This is nothing but a prospective cohort study. This design. What happens in case of retrospective cohort study? So data on exposure status and disease is already collected in past. Somebody has already collected. And it is available in records. That is very important. So let us consider that there is a factory where several workers are working. So every there are very good records of when a person joined this factory, in which section he is working, and record of his exposure, how long he has been working in particular division. So such records are available. And he's, because being in a factory, they undergo periodic medical examination. So these records are also available. And we know that from records, how many individuals develop disease, how many not develop disease. So information about exposure and disease is already collected, available in terms, available in the record. What the investigator does, he collects the information about exposure and illness by reviewing the record. And the key thing here is he links the data from exposure to disease. So basically, he starts with individuals who are exposed, like the factory workers who are working in one particular section, that is the exposed group. He takes another group of individuals who are working in unexposed group on the basis of available records. And from the records, he also follows them to find out how many diseased individuals develop in one group, compares the incidence in other group. Retrospective, by the very word says that the information about disease and exposure is already collected. It has already occurred, it is already collected, it is well maintained, records are very good. But the logic is he starts with a group of individuals who do not have the disease to start with, but there are some people who are exposed, some people who are not exposed. Let us consider that there is a hospital and there is a radiology department, and data is available when radiologists have joined the department. And maybe they are every year they have to undergo how much radiation they have been exposed to. So that exposure data is available. And the data also is available about their service and how many of them have developed a particular form of cancer. So investigator goes, collects this data, takes another group, maybe doctors working in medicine, and find out what is the incidence of that particular cancer in medicine or physicians, and compares. And there can be a mixture of two studies, like prospective and retrospective study. So exposure status is available, have been collected in past, and there are good records, but they are not sufficient outcomes asset. These individuals can further be followed, and the information of about outcome can be collected prospectively. So now we will see how to conduct a cohort study. What are the steps? As I told you, the first step is selection of study cohort. And objective of this step is selection of representative sample of exposed and unexposed groups. So we want somebody who is exposed to that particular risk factor, a group of individual, and a group which is not exposed to that particular factor. And there are two approaches of selecting this cohort. You can select the cohort from general population. Okay, in general population there will be somebody who is exposed to that group, somebody is not exposed to that. So the second example, general population sample. If the exposure is heterogeneous, somebody is exposed, somebody is not exposed, then there will be two groups. One group is exposed group, one group is unexposed group, and this group can be followed till they develop a particular outcome. Another example is spatial exposure group. These are spatial exposure because of their because of unusual exposure or unusual lifestyle. The example of radiologist, see, this is spatial exposure. Everybody doesn't get exposed to X-rays often. Because of their occupation, they are exposed more. So if you want to see the effect of this radiation in developing particular form of cancer, it is ideal to take a spatial exposure. So elements that can define a population for a cohort. Cohort means because some group of individuals stay in one locality, it can form a cohort because of certain demographic characteristic, like infants are like born today, that will become a cohort because of their cultural background, because of their employment, or because of their common experience or condition, like occupation. So all these things make them as a part of cohort. Now, just to explain this step, I'm going to give an example of a famous Framingham heart study. This is one of the oldest studies. It was started in 50s to find out the risk factors for CHD, and this study has produced more than 300 publications, still going on, and one of the excellent follow-up studies. Long-term epidemiological investigation of CHD, hypertension and other cardiovascular diseases. And for that, they selected 6,507 individuals, aged 30 to 60 years that time. And these individuals were selected randomly from Framingham. And 4,469 individuals participated. So our first step was selection of cohort. Okay. So this cohort was selected from the general population. So the second part, the factors favoring long-term follow-up of study. So they selected this particular town, Framingham, purposefully actually, because it has a population of 28,000, and they thought that they can select 6,000 individuals randomly from that. They didn't want a very large town. It was a compact town, and there was only one hospital in that town. So hospital care at single central hospital, because of that, study population could be observed conveniently by means of examination. And it was a relatively stable population. Therefore, it was possible for them to follow for more than 50 years. Once you select a cohort, whether it is from a special exposure group or from general population, next step is gathering baseline information. And the objective is to find out who is exposed, who is not exposed. If it is a special exposure group, everybody of course will be exposed. So objective is to do a valid assessment of exposure status, to find out who already has a disease. Those who already have the disease definitely can't develop another disease. They should be removed. Find out individuals who are at risk of the disease. Exclude individuals having disease at baseline. And establish basis for follow-up. Because this group, now we have to follow them further. So you collect identifying data, you take informed consent from them, and you seek their commitment for agreeing to participate in the study, and also obtain data regarding other co-variables. And this has been told several times, data collection has to be objective, accurate and precise. We will not go again into that. How are we going to collect the baseline information? Baseline information may be available through existing records, like employment records or hospital records. You can interview the individuals or maybe mail questionnaires. This also was done in one of the studies, cohort studies. By examination, the examination may be medical examination or other special examinations. In occupational setting, the measurement of environment is frequently used, like exposure to radiation or air pollution. One of the objective of making this baseline collecting this baseline information is to form a comparison group. So comparison group can be internal comparison group, like the initial we take a general population, we find out who is exposed, and those who are not exposed become a comparable group. comparison group. Okay, external comparison group. Now consider that the example of radiologists. There all the radiologists are exposed. So you can't make some radiologists who are exposed and who are not exposed. So you'll have to take external comparison group. Say a physician working in medicine department or gynecologist who are not exposed to X-rays. So what they did in the Framingham Heart study? So they selected a cohort of 6,000 odd individuals randomly, and they did an initial examination, interviewed the individuals, and characterized them with respect to certain risk factors like blood cholesterol, blood pressure, cigarette smoking, and BMI. Okay. So their exposure variables were blood cholesterol, blood pressure, cigarette smoking, and BMI. So those who is having cholesterol above a particular level become exposed, and those who are having below that level become unexposed. They also did medical history examination and ECG and medical tests. So of the 4,469 individuals who agreed to participate. See, 4,469 individuals finally participated. They selected 6,000 odd individuals randomly, but other people told that we are not interested. But 4,469 individuals told that they are willing to participate in the study. And on the basis of these examinations, 76 individuals had already had cardiovascular event, and therefore these individuals were excluded from the study. So they were left with 4,393 individuals who are at risk of getting CVD, cardiovascular disease. So the objective of this examination was to find out the comparison group as well as to find out the individuals who are at risk of developing the disease. Okay. So here the comparison group was internal comparison group. They also established a basis for follow-up. Every subject of the 4,393 individuals was followed up 2 yearly. And then they collected in detail the name of relative, friend, family, physician, because they wanted to follow. So it was so meticulous that's why they could do it for last 50 years. Third step and one of the important step in cohort study is uniform and complete follow-up of all the cohort. And if you don't follow, or if you follow one group properly, one group not completely, then biases can come in your study.
Simultaneously.
Yeah, simultaneously as well as completely. Like, you are not following one group. In Framingham study, they decided that every individual, whether he is exposed or unexposed, whether he is having hypertension or not, will be examined every 2 years.
Typically, cohort studies will start with exposed status and non-exposed. This is what we are saying. But in Framingham, probably some of the risk factors, when they started the study in 1950s, they didn't know that is a risk factor for that. But they do have that record.
Yes.
They did have that record. So later on, when the disease developed, they look into the measurements that they had them 30 years back or 20 years back and found out that, okay, fine, this is a risk factor. So in that way, it looks like more of a retrospective one because it is after the case control. But somehow, we classify this as a classical example of a cohort study. So in that way, we can say that sometimes, can we say that sometimes that cohort study can also start without exactly classifying that these are the exposed and these are the non-exposed?
Yes.
That sort of thing, that's a little bit of a controversy.
But basically, initially though it was a demonstration project, but 1951, it was considered as a cohort study, and they started with these four risk factors. That is blood cholesterol, blood pressure, cigarette smoking, and BMI. So what did they do in Framingham Heart study? So they followed every individual after 2 years. The key method of follow-up was repeated medical examination. So during first 14 years, more than 85% of the participants who were still alive, because somebody will die naturally, came in for examination. So after 14 years, they could examine 85% of the original cohort of 4,000 odd. The next 12 years, that is 26 years after the original study, their follow-up rate was 80%. That is really remarkable, actually. And that was only possible because it was a small town, only one facility, one hospital facility, all the stable economy. Okay. They also did, as I told you, they also did some indirect methods of follow-up through secondary sources of information. Because we know that vital registration system is very good there in USA. So they could follow some of the individuals who migrated for whether they are alive or died. Only for these two outcomes. Not for whether they developed hypertension or whether they developed cardiovascular event. And the criteria for diagnosis of cardiovascular event was precisely defined, and that remained same throughout the follow-up period. Because you can't change, like you, today this is your definition for classifying a person as deceased. You can't change it tomorrow, that no, we will change it. So all through 26 years, of these 26 years, their the criteria remained same. So that is one of the important thing in the cohort study. Any doubt, questions till this point of time? No? Then it is really post-lunch syndrome, actually. Okay. Well, this is how we present the data in analytical cohort study. This is class. This is 2x2 table, and you might have seen a Hanuman's photograph, actually, na? Opening his chest and seeing Ram inside that. Actually, one of my colleague, Dr. Hutin, he was telling that epidemiologists, if you do that way, you'll see a 2x2 table, not four this thing, but 2x2 table. So this is 2x2 table, and we basically every time we start with ill and non-ill and exposure this side. We'll go a little bit further into these incidents now. And first is, what is risk? So risk is nothing but a proportion of initially disease-free individuals that develop the disease or become injured or dies. That is outcome. So those who are initially disease-free, they are followed, they develop the disease. So in numerator, we have a number of new cases of disease during a specified period, new cases. And in denominator, we have size of total population at the start of the period. So initially, we take 100 individuals, 10 of them develop the disease. The risk becomes 10 out of 100 or 10%. It is also called as attack rate. And attack rate, this word is commonly used in case of outbreaks or epidemics. It is also called as cumulative incidence. Cumulative incidence. We'll see why it's cumulative. Now let us consider that this yellow circles are 8 individuals. They enter a cohort study and they were followed for a particular period of time. A red circle indicates development of disease. So out of these 8, 2 develop the disease. The incidence is 2x8. Is it okay? That is 25%. Now, just to give some more these examples. In the study of diabetics, 100 of the 189 diabetic men died during a 13-year follow-up period. What is the risk of death? Yes? 100 by? Okay. That's correct. It's about 52.9%. The risk of death is 52.9%. Another example. There was an outbreak of gastroenteritis among attendees of a picnic. 99% ate potato salad. It was nice that it was not there today. 30 of these people who consumed this potato salad developed gastroenteritis. 30 by 99. And the risk of risk is 30 by 99, which is 30.3%. It is also called as, especially in this outbreak context, it can also be called as food specific attack rate. So if it is an outbreak and there are 5 kinds of food consumed, we'll calculate food specific attack rate and find out where the risk is more. And there are certain properties of incidence proportion. It measures the risk of disease. It is a measure of risk of disease basically, or it is also a probability of developing the disease during a specified time. Okay. Numerator has only number of new cases. Denominator has number of persons who were disease free at the start of the cohort study, at the start of follow-up. And it is a proportion, because numerator is a part of denominator. Let us consider another example of the same 8 individuals. And these were followed up for 7 years. Okay. This blue line indicates denote observation, and the gap between 2 bars is 1 year. So 8 individuals, this total follow up was 7 years. Each yellow line is a person which is followed up. So first person was followed up for 1 year, second one was followed up for 7, third was 4th 7 years, 5th one 6th. Okay. The red dot, the red circle basically indicates development of disease, whereas the yellow diamond indicates that a person is lost to follow. How do you calculate now the incidence?
4 have completed the study.
4 have completed the study?
Yes, 2 have
done. Okay. But see, if you want to calculate the risk, how will you calculate the risk? Risk, what do you take in denominator? At the start of study. So risk, as per the risk, how much it will be?
2 over
8. Okay, that is 1 by 4, 25%. That is what we have already seen. But here, all have not been followed up. Or they were followed up for different periods of time. And that is what will happen in cohort study. As he told, somebody will die, somebody will go out, somebody may come in. So dynamic cohort, somebody may come in, somebody may go out. So what? How do you go about this different follow-up? So for that we have another solution. It's called incidence rate. It is also called as person time rate. It is a measure of incidence that incorporates time, okay, in the denominator. It is usually calculated for long-term cohort for studies, wherein enrollees are followed up over a period of time and the occurrence of new cases is documented. So each person is then observed from initial point till the 4 endpoints are reached. That is, he develops a disease, he dies out, he goes out of study, frustrated and goes out of the study, and study is over. So how do you calculate this incidence rate or person time rate? So numerator consists of number of individuals who develop the disease. Here it is 2. In the same example, 2 persons develop the disease. Denominator includes the denominator is the sum of time each person was under follow-up, and it is totaled for all persons. So basically, it denominator includes total time the population was under follow. Okay. So this is the formula for that. Number of new cases of disease during a specific period divided by time each person was observed, total for whole population. And now, how can you calculate the incidence rate in this thing? How much is that?
2
by, yeah.
Then you put 1 times 1 plus 1 times 7 plus 1 times 4.
Why don't you calculate actually? 2 by 41. Everybody agrees? Yes. That's correct. Total person here is 2 by 41. Total number of persons developing disease 2. So incidence rate is 4.9 per 100 person year. So if you follow 100 persons, what does this 4.9 per 100 person year mean? If you follow 100 persons for 1 year, there will be 4.9 cases. See, this person contributed 1 year. This person can contributed 7 years. 7 plus 1, 8. 9, 10, 11, 12. 12 plus 7, 19. 21, 28, 35, 41. So this is person year that is 41 evaluated. So what are the properties of incidence rate? It describes how quickly the disease is going to is occurring in the population. So here it is, the rate is 4.9 per 1000 per 100 person years. If the rate is 10 per year, it is more. So in a year, out of 100 individuals, 10% will develop the disease. So it describes how quickly the disease occurs in a population. Because it includes person time follow-up for each individual, it can accommodate persons coming in or going out of study. So it accounts for subjects who are lost to follow-up and allows subjects to enter at different time. But there is one problem with this. See, the drawback is it assumes that the disease occurs at the same rate, same probability.
Over time.
On the other hand, we know that as a person, say for example age, we know that as a person gets older, he is more likely to develop a chronic disease. But here, we consider that for each year, followed up, he contributes same, he has the same risk. That is the problem. So now we will see the measure of association in a cohort study, that is risk ratio. So risk ratio is nothing but risk of disease. We have seen what is risk. The first thing what we saw was risk. Two kind of incidence we saw. One was risk, the number of new cases over total individuals at a beginning of follow-up, that is risk. So the risk ratio is risk of disease in a group of primary interest, that is among exposed, divided by risk of disease among unexposed. So if your risk, relative risk is 1, it means risk is same in both the groups. So there is no extra risk because of the exposure. If RR is 1, it means that there is increased risk for those who are exposed. So if relative risk is less than 1, it means that there is a decreased risk for those who are exposed. That is how it is calculated. This is 2 by 2 table, and relative risk is very simple actually. This is an example again, it is given in this thing. This example is about transmission of MTB among congregated HIV infected persons, prison inmates in USA. The study was done in one of the prisons where HIV positive individuals were kept. A total 294 individuals were there, and they were staying in two wings, east wing and west wing. 157 individuals were staying in east wing, 137 were staying in west wing. 28 individuals developed the disease here, and 28 individuals in East Wing developed the disease compared to 4 individuals in West Wing. So what is the risk ratio? How will you calculate it? How will you calculate risk ratio? Risk of TB among East Wing inmates. How much is that? 28 by?
157.
Yeah. 157, not 129. Risk of TB among West Wing inmates?
Very good.
And what is the relative risk? Ratio of that, which is 6 times. So they found out that those inmates who were staying in East Wing, they were at six times higher risk of getting TB. For we found out the other kind of the other type of incidence, that is incidence rate, which takes this person time into follow. If that is the case, we calculate a rate ratio. A rate ratio is nothing but it compares the incidence rates in two groups. Rate for primary interest, that is exposed, and rate for unexposed. Another example for that. See, public health officials were called to investigate a perceived increase in visits of ships infirmaries for ARI by passengers of cruise ship in Alaska in 1998. Okay. The officials compared passenger visit to ship hospital for ARI during May and August 1998 with those of ARI figures in 1997. And the incidence rate in 1998 was 11.6 per 1,000 tourists per week, whereas incidence in last year, the earlier year, was 5.3. It means it was the rate ratio was 2.2. So the risk of the rate ratio or for the disease for ARI was 2 times this year. And then finally they found out that there was a case of influenza, and that's how the spread was there. What happened in Framingham study, this last slide. See, they divided the cohort into as per serum cholesterol less than 210 and more than 210. And these are the second column says the number of individuals at the start of the cohort, number of cases of cardiovascular disease in each of the group, and the relative risk. How do you interpret the relative risk of 1.81 in individuals having serum cholesterol of 210? They are at 1.8 times higher risk of developing cardiovascular disease compared to those who are having less than 210.